Start it. Zombie on the track. Started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the bottom, now my whole team fucking here. Started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the...
Now, 10 years later, Daniel takes the stage to present probably one of the most exciting stealth companies in Israel that most people haven't heard of and are going to hear a lot about tomorrow. Is that right?
Yeah.
So tomorrow is their launch, and they just did a bunch of press today. Zvol, his co-founder, was going to present, but he's like too bogged down talking to press. So it's going to go live in terms of being announced to the world tomorrow, but today we get to hear it. Just for the TechAviv Founders Club, and Daniel, thank you for coming back and presenting Lumen. Take it away.
Hi guys, so this is exciting because it's the first time after 4.5 years of grinding this project, we're putting our hearts out and being out like tomorrow. So I'm super excited by presenting and by basically by just being out. So I've been working on this project with the team of entrepreneurs. We've been doing this for 4.5 years, but actually this is our third company. The first one, as Yaron said, was a search engine back in 2007. We did tons of mistakes. We were students. It's not an excuse. We learned a lot in the process. It was a search engine that even founders never bothered to search with. And that was kind of the realization of, wow, probably no one will use it. It took us 2.5 years to get to that understanding. But we found a good team, and we continue to work together. So that's the plus in that sense. Next company we built, we launched after 4 months. It was called Wibia. Product for publishers. Was basically sold for to Conduit, another Israeli company, after a fairy tale story of 2.5 years. And since then, after leading the innovation group at Conduit for 2.5 years, finishing our vesting, we left and started working on this project, which is actually not my idea, it's my wife's. So Roland and myself, working together for tons of time, my spouse Michal and her twin sister Merav, they are the brain science, nutrition, physiology, everything smart behind what we're doing. And what are we doing? We are actually building a device that can measure your metabolism in the brain and can tell you what's happening if your body is utilizing fat or carbs as fuel. And it's not binary, it's levels. I'll show you in a second. And from that, when you do that in the morning, it will tell you what you should be eating to achieve a healthier weight, to optimize your workouts. And because Shai, at a very harsh call, told me to focus, so we're solving diets, basically. That's what we're doing.
Yeah,
I looked
this morning, I saw the beginning.
So that's what we're doing. We're giving you a sense of control, a very short feedback loop. I'm talking techie and professional with you guys because you can value those things. But this is a game changer in terms of really understanding what I did yesterday and its impact on me today, basically. So everything that you do, sleep, eating, carbs, fat, working out, everything kind of shows an effect and basically impact your metabolism. So we didn't invent the metric, we just took a 60 minutes measurement process that you go through in a metabolic cart like this woman connected to a mask, or me in Mount Sinai in New York in a metabolic chamber. 60 minutes of breathing into a $10,000, $20,000 device, and we managed to minimize that to a single breath and a handheld device that will cost, the beginning, $200. Moving forward, the goal is to even lower that more. And how it looks like, it basically you install the app, take the device, I'll show in a second the demo because that's the purpose of this session. You choose your journey. We stopped only with weight loss and we're focusing only on that. But as you grow and as you continue to use it, you can do muscle gain and you can do ketogenic diets and you can improve your health. We unlock your day, we take a measurement, we'll show you if you're burning fat as fuel, that would be a fat burn stage, or if you're burning carbs, that would be you guys after a pizza night with friends and having fun. And we give you a goal. And we gamify this process of getting you to your goal, basically. And by doing that each morning, we have already about 70 users. I know it's small, but it's an iterative process. We have 70 users in New York losing significant weight, already using it for 4 months. 70% of them are losing significant weight and being able to maintain it. There is no food logging, there is no nothing. It just, you take a breath, you answer a few questions in the morning about yesterday, and you get a plan for today. That's us. I'll switch to demo the device and get your questions. This is tech. Too much tech in my head. So this is a kind of a non-kosher measurement because what you'll see is a measurement while I'm standing, but you'll get a sense of it. I'll explain how it works. So basically, sorry for that. So basically what we do is we measure CO2. We measure CO2 in your breath, and the content of CO2 in this specific maneuver that I'm going to show you in a second will indicate if you're using carbs or using fats. When you use carbs, basically you have more CO2 in your breath, and when you're using fat, you'll see less, lower concentration. Obviously, we look at data from your phone, sleep, activity, we take everything into account. We ask you a few questions, and you're basically off to it. This guy takes a warm-up of 30 seconds. The one that will be released to the public is immediate. Maybe something interesting about the process, it took us a lot of time to develop a sensor. It's not an off-the-shelf one. So we basically did stuff that didn't scale and designed and implemented a $1,000 sensor to 100 units just to test the software, to see that people will breathe, people will follow the plan, people will lose weight. That was our first goal, even though we didn't have a sensor and we didn't know if we can really achieve it and be done with the development. So what I'm going to do now is inhale through the device, hold the air in my lungs for 10 seconds, and then exhale.
The reflector.
Big enough crowd, someone could have told me that it's not presented.
Have the reflector up on the Mac?
This would be my status. I'm currently using half and half. Well, it's not reflective because I'm standing. You should do it sitting down, relaxed, not presenting it. But it's working, and it gets people very much aware and excited about what's happening in their body. And I think the biggest achievement is that it makes them care. It makes them care about their food. They are aware of what they're eating, and they make basically better choices than worse choices. This is time for your questions, feedback, everything.
Okay. Maybe you should put up the site while we're doing that. All right. So. Yes, Omer, in the back.
Hey, what's up?
What's up?
I'm assuming you did a lot of user research. So if you've been working on this for a couple of years, what are like the key insights that you found during those sessions with the users? What do they care about? What do they care less about? How do you kind of design this to be something that you use constantly and not churn off after a while?
It's a great question. It's actually it's a super tough process that it's called customer discovery. It's not user testing in the sense that you don't put them in a room, but it's the thing that actually we're most proud of, in a sense. We gave that same device to people in last September, onboarded 5 users every week, and basically they churned after 2 days, the first batch, and we just improved the guidance of how to get there. And then they churned because they didn't understand the results screen. What does that mean for them? And as we grew from feedback, basically, and gave better recommendation, and we basically simplified everything, and brought in product and kind of removed the science, people got more and more engaged. And at some point in January, the cohort that started never left voluntarily. We just took
it. So the size of the cohort is like 5 people, basically?
Yes, okay. Yes.
You're basically designing a device that is supposed to use behavior-changing analytics, like Fitbit,
right.
Basically. You're trying to address the same goal of helping people diet or reach a certain health rate. And the question here is the real problem with these types of devices is that it's hard to get persistence over time. People will try it out, they'll buy a device for 100, 200, whatever. And after days, weeks, months, most of them churn. And the only people that are left after a while that could be your driving force for increased repeat sales are people who are probably kind of a side thing, already using other Fitbit or whatever. What's your value add? If people already know they're supposed to be better, they probably know what they should be eating. How do these analytics improve behavior better than Fitbit or other things that people are
doing? I think that's the only thing that they do. We optimize on that. So to your question, I think Fitbit is a very interesting example. 75 million devices that were sold. It shows that people care, right? The wellness is taking care of my own health to some extent before I need the doctor. So people care, people buy, people do stuff around that. You look at Weight Watchers, it's 3 million customers, but a $5 billion company. So we want to get the Weight Watcher business model, which is subscription and which is behavioral change, and focus on that and get it to fit its scale and sensor.
If I may, the thing I think the driving force for actual change is not the measurement, but the external social, I'll call it drivers. As in, you're like when you have an AA meeting or they weigh in each week and they feel bad, not just in front of themselves in the mirror, but in front of their peer groups if they don't actually make some sort of improvement. So my recommendation would be actually creating some sort of social, I don't know if it's gamified or some sort of support group where your users have an external commitment, not just internal one of, I got 97% or whatever, I'm just burning calories, carbs now, but something that actually gives them real drive like the other successful models.
I think it's a great one.
Yeah,
but I... What's your distribution?
So we're starting with consumers, direct to consumer. The reason is that we explore channels, and it's such an innovation that no one's, including nutritionists, can actually educating them at any channel to be the educator of its own market. It's harder than just putting it out there and getting the first support of users. So we want to build an online brand that talks about that the uniqueness of mentoring metabolism and start there. And we have ideas for channels, but I think we can grow today to an interesting scale just online.
Is considered on TikTok?
Oh, tomorrow it's on Indiegogo.
Oh.
Yeah.
Has anyone built a hardware product for consumers here? Yeah. What's the name of your company?
I'm invested in
And so any feedback on the requirement of a hardware device in order to do this sort of quantify itself, analytics, experience on distributing a hardware device to consumers, best practices on that front from that experience?
Yeah. I can give you the bad experience. I had a children toy into USB. Patent on emotions of children, totally messed it up in the world, had a huge success in Israel, and mostly we fell for the Chinese in terms of how we manufacture things. So we had a lot of problems working with the Chinese and how to build the right product and deliver it fast. Most of the problems were when you have success. When you have to build only 1,000 units, that's not a problem. When you have to do 100,000 units and ship it, that's where the problem begins. So that's, I don't know how you work with the other side of the world, but they don't talk. They work differently.
Yeah.
And the other thing is the channels. And we discovered that marketing is completely different from different kinds of perspective. Everybody wants to be successful, but if you're not successful, it's very hard with the channels. Very, very hard. We work with both of us. And today, we thought about the channels and the new product that we built, which is not a toy, it's more security for home. We went for Kickstarter. We sold 14,000 in 2 weeks. We did over a million in Kickstarter and a million in Indiegogo. And we had the same. We learned how, I can give you a whole lecture how to do work with the Chinese today, but we bypassed the channels by having success Kickstarter, getting everybody to invest. Because if you knock on doors in the US, it's useless. So I don't know how you're going to lose the distribution plan. You can end up with a product that sells 500 units and do nothing, and so that's one problem. Another one is, I don't know how much effort you put in technology and how fast the Chinese will copy you. But the minute we had a product on Kickstarter, it took 2 weeks for to read on Alibaba. Okay? So keep in mind patents and stuff like that, Alibaba, Amazon, whatever, if you present a patent, they will take it down. But no, keep in mind.
That's great feedback. Maybe you guys can chat afterwards a little bit more. We're out of time. We have to go to the next session. Daniel, thank you very much.